so many amendments within a span of about 12 years. Of course, that displays the dynamism of the law in a way, but in another sense, this actually was an effort and an exercise as one could make, having the benefit of hindsight. These 12 years were a period of trial and error. 1994 notification till the year 2006, umpteen amendments came to this law, and by and large, the dilution of the law was more evident than making the law more tight and secure. With the result, there was a lot of murmur that this law is more industry friendly than environment friendly, and as such, it is better to scrap this law. The government did not keep quiet. For well over some 2-3 years, it had appointed a couple of expert committees to look into the working of this law over time, and based on the recommendations and in consultation with several interest groups, including the industry, and primarily the industry, it came up with a notification, and that is the law that is in operation now, the EIA notification of the year 2006. And we will elaborately discuss that now. What are its salient features? The Environment Impact Assessment Law puts developmental activities under various categories of activities. And it also puts on a rational path that the environmental clearance for these different categories of activities need not necessarily go through a particular process whereby only the central government would take a decision. It was highly centralized earlier. We would like to decentralize that. So we'll decide on levels of decision making on environmental clearance depending on the kind or the nature of the activity and the category in which it's put. As many as 9 groups of activities and projects that require prior environmental clearance were listed out in the schedule. So there is a schedule under this notification. I urge the students to have a look at this schedule just to acquaint themselves as to the kind of activities and the projects that require primary environmental clearance, and these are in the list that's available in the schedule. How do they really decide on the categories or the nature of projects? Well, the categorization of projects is based on the spatial extent. What is the space that this particular project or a developmental activity would take? Is it something which occupies a lot of area, covering several kinds of flora and fauna within that, having different kinds of topographies coming within its purview, where exactly it's going to be located, based upon which a particular kind of categorization. And much more than that, the potential impact of this project on human health and natural and man-made resources were factored in before these were classified as categories that require mandatory environmental clearance at different levels. That means environmental clearances are going to take place at 2 levels. One at the state level and another at the central level. And those that are put under category A, they require the central clearance or the Ministry of Environment and Forest clearance. And those that are put in category B are to be cleared by the state government. The agency which would carry out that impact assessment at the central level is what is referred to as Environment Appraisal Committee, EAC, and at the state level it is called State Environment Impact Assessment Authority, SEIAA. These are the ones which will take the call at their level for that particular category of a developmental activity, based upon these criteria, and then take a decision. Decisions of the respective bodies are to be based on the recommendation of this particular committee at the central and at the state level, new projects, expansion, modernization, change in the product, etc., all get covered under the various categories under which these appear. What is the state level authority? SEIAA. Interestingly, under this law, the state level appraisal body or the recommendatory body, this is something that is to be constituted by the central government itself. So even the state body is set up by the central government, but while setting it up, the central government will consult the state government. It's a very small body, just a three-member body. There is a chairman, there is a member, and a secretary. The secretary is a serving officer of the government who is familiar with environmental laws to be nominated by the state government. There is a scope for co-option of any other expert in this as and when occasions arose, as and when a particular kind of developmental activity requiring a particular kind of expertise, they could co-opt other people also as experts here. Only experts or professionals can be in this committee. So to be the chairman or to be a member, you need have to be an expert or a professional. Who is an expert or a professional? It's a very interesting formulation. I will come to that, but let me just go through the two levels of clearance. The first level is SEIAA at the state level, and the second one at the central level, which clears A category projects, the Environment Appraisal Committee or the Approval Committee, the membership. Here you just have a look. The qualification is to be a member, one can be experts and professionals. At the state level, expert or professionals. At the national level, only experts and professionals. It's a big body because it spans India significance and so reach. And so you need a lot more people than what you have at the state level. And so major projects that come under category A, the number of persons who should be there should not be more than 15 in number. It will have a chairman, it will have a member secretary, and the chairman is an outstanding and experienced environmental policy expert, or he may be an expert in management, or he may be an expert in public administration. And in case there is the chairman not being available for indisposition or for any other reason in the meetings, he can nominate one of the remaining members as the vice chairman who would preside over the meetings in the former's absence. To be the secretary, that person should be a representative of the Environment Ministry to assist the committee as its secretary. So the secretary is nominated by the Environment Ministry at the central level. At the state level, it could be anybody who can be appointed, but he has to be from the government, who is nominated by the state government, who is supposed to be familiar with environmental laws, needed to be appointed for that. Now, who is a professional and who is an expert, who can take the call, peruse all those applications, go through the project reports, and come up with the recommendation for the government to act upon? Well, these members are either professionals or experts, and a professional is someone who has an MA or an MSc degree, master's degree in sciences and arts, or Bachelor of Engineering or Bachelor of Technology, a lawyer, a chartered accountant, an IAS officer, an IFS fellow, Indian Forest Service, Master of Public Administration. And not just that, with this qualification, they should have experience in the respective field of clearance that is required for those environment related environmentally affecting developmental activities. So these are referred to as professionals. So a professional is someone who has academic qualifications along with professional experience, and that is a professional. And who is an expert? Very interesting. An expert is a professional with at least 15 years of experience in the field or with a PhD with 10 years. So this is a super professional. Whereas a professional does not have these 15 years of experience, and a professional need not have a PhD. So it can be either 15 years experience or a PhD, which will actually set apart experts from professionals. But the sum and substance of it is, the EAC, for its membership, you should be an expert. You can be a professional. Then only you shall qualify to be in this particular committee. So very high profile body, very well informed group of very academically, professionally accomplished group in wide variety of areas of human activity. The only requirement is that each of the member should not have crossed 70 years of age, but the government will get the option of extending it up to the age of 75 years on a case-by-case basis, depending upon the need and also the level of expertise without which the committee may not be able to function. And so there is a need that up to 75 years, one can remain a professional expert to be in this particular committee. There is also a scope for considering other professionals and other experts with sufficient experience. So here is a very interesting law. In one of the appendix, comes up with a very clear guideline as to who would be a professional, who would be an expert, and then later dilutes it a bit, that the state will have the jurisdiction, the government will exercise the discretionary power to decide whether other professionals who may not have those academic qualifications, other experts who may not have the kind of experience in the government as is required under this law, but have sufficient experience as convincing the government to appoint them. Well, so there is where you see a bit of a difficulty of a bit of dilution in the composition of this body in contemplation under this law. Maximum of 2 years term of, I mean, 2 terms of 3 years each is what is being provided. They cannot be removed before the term without proper inquiry and giving a show cause notice to that effect. And every 3 years, this will be constituted. And what is their job? They have to carry out the screening, carrying out the scoping, and they have to do the appraisal of projects. What is the screening, scoping, and appraisal? We'll come to that a little while later. And we will discuss it in greater detail because these are the stages of EIA process, and that requires elaborate analysis. And this is their job, to screen, to have the scope, and appraise projects, and meet at least once a month. And among the members there, the committee need have to authorize one member or a number of members to go and inspect the project sites or activities to get the field experience, to know for themselves, by themselves, physically, about the claims that are made or, and authenticate them with prior notice of at least 7 days and the function of the principle of collective responsibility. So, if a member is authorized and he comes back and reports, the report is supposed to be the report of the entire committee. And the decision that is made, it can be a unanimous decision or it can be by a majority. But in case there is a division, then the majority will prevail and that will be the decision of the entire committee. The application for the environmental clearance are provided in the appendix, and there has to be a pre-feasibility project report, the exceptions, construction projects, conceptual plans, all being given under this subordinate instruments to this particular notification.